First thing I'm going to ask is that everyone except me and Will mute your mics. We'll have like opportunities to ask questions and for you to all say crazy shit later. What else? If things get too tough, we might automatically mute people on entry. Like someone might enter and, you know, have their mic on and just start chatting. So just know that. And, you know, I'm sure in chat, you know, if you have questions, put that there and I'll try to look at that. The other function you can use is to raise your hand, which should be a button right below the participant list. All right. So, all right. One more reminder.
Quick, Charles, sorry, one second. On that note, if Charles and Brent, if you could tell me, I have my screen maximized for this slide, so I can't see if anybody raised their hands or anything.
Yeah. I'll basically call them out. Brent has the banhammer and is the host. He is going to go around rigorously muting people, but also unmuting them if they, you know, I call on them. So I'll say, you know, hey, Alex has raised his hand and, you know, Alex, what's your question? And then Brent ideally will unmute him and, you know, he can ask his question and then we'll move on from there. Okay. This way I don't have to automatically mute all of you. Okay. So we've got two people, JR, G, and Simon. If you could mute, that would be nice. And we will get, or Brent will do it for you.
Yeah, I can go ahead and do that.
Okay, cool. All right, well, we've got 33 people. So for those of you who don't know, Will Buschur is an instructor at CKDF. He teaches longsword, polearms, messer, dagger. What don't you teach?
I mean, I'm not really good at ringing yet. And then on the one hand, like the rapier, I like Josec, but I don't know really anything about it, so I guess that's tough.
Okay, so my shitty intro will be like, Will, he doesn't do ringing, and he doesn't do one-handed stuff. But
I do ringing, I just can't teach it.
He does everything else.
Just call me KDF boy. I just try to do the KDF to the best.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, cool. You know, most of us are in the club, so we already know Will, but we've got a few people who are outside. And in the future, we have a lot of external speakers, so I'll be a little bit more formal. The mic's no good. We tried to fix it, but this is the best that we have. Oh, thank you. Will's here to talk to us today about his research on wounds. Wounds caused by swords, wounds caused by other things? I don't remember.
Yeah.
So please take it away.
Yeah, sure. So, sorry, I can't hear myself how my mic is. I'm sorry about that. I tried to get the app working on my phone with my earbuds, but it didn't. It was all wonky. So, sorry about that. But the presentation here, I have some slides to go through. I want to go through the slides just to kind of give everybody a basis in how I've approached this idea that I had some, like, it was a few years ago now. It's crazy how time passes. But the basic idea here is thinking about how the Kunstus Fechtens in particular, but I guess, you know, HEMA, you know, historical sources generally understand or depict or want to, or I guess understand how the wounding of, you know, of your opponent. The issue that I have a lot is that I ran into in the years ago when I was looking at this stuff, I wasn't sure about what happens after you're told to set your point on him or drive to the opening. It seems like the sources that we studied kind of, they tell you how to get to the wound, but they don't tell you much about, you know, why they're what you should expect next. And I think this is a really modern problem, perhaps. I mean, you know, because you know, we don't get in fights nowadays where we're wounding each other, you know, or somebody trying to kill us, thankfully. And so it's not, so again, it's kind of this it's kind of this extra lost context for the fact books that we study. So let me give you some examples about what I'm talking about specifically here. So you see here, this is from the Goliath fact book. I'm going to go in here. I have the link here. This is the one that you want, the giant sword guys, you know. And you see here, can you see my mouse? Is that visible?
I'm afraid not. I don't see your mouse. Sorry.
Well,
yeah,
no
I
worries.
See the mouse.
The guy on the left in the green, I'm just circling my mouse over around the tip of the red guy's sword. Everybody see that tip mm-hmm. coming out?
Yeah.
So this is a very rare depiction of a wound from one of the KDF treatises that we know about and study. You see here that I think this is from the Mutirin, maybe, or no, it's not Mutirin. Anyway, Red Gambeson guy has wound and thrust into the upper left opening of green guy, and you see the wound being depicted here. That's good for us because we're saying, oh yeah, you know, we can understand that, yeah, we're supposed to thrust all the way through, you know, stuff like that. But it's rare. The only other depiction of a wound in the Goliath effect book illustrations is this one. So if you can you see the wound? It's kind of hard to tell. Raise your hand if you see the
yeah.
wound.
Yeah.
Somebody tell me if we have a lot of raised hands or not.
Yeah. Yeah. Look at the left-hand fencer's leg.
It's like, where's Waldo?
I know, yeah. Find the wound.
Where's the wound?
left-hand fencer's taking it in the right thigh, right? And so you know, right fencer is winding and thrusting into the lower opening, and that's there. Sure enough, you see a wound getting depicted here. But the thing is, though, the fencing treatises that we study, they almost never depict the wound at all. Period. They don't even really tell you about the wound. They just tell you to, you know, to strike into the head. We'll look in the text a little bit in a second. But images like this one, you see left fencer's tip, his point. It's right against the chest of right yeah. fencer. He's not actually thrusting at all. And by the way, that matches pretty well. I think that matches pretty well the text for a lot of these techniques. I don't actually tell you, you know, thrust through or do anything. So this one is I have an opinion about whether it's depicting a wound, but this is the only other kind of edge case. So what do you think? Is the right fencer, is he being wounded? Is that a depiction of wound? Like, is that blood? I don't know.
Scalp strike. You got some yeses.
It may be, right? It may be some, you know, it's an old manuscript. I think it might be some blood.
But in Goliath, there's what, roughly 100 illustrations?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and to find that many, or so few wounds.
And that's the basic issue that prompted me to look into wounding, quote, which is a weird word, right? Wounding, mm-hmm. but, you know, inflicting wounds in with swords. Because it seems, it's, I don't know, for me, when one of the sources does not have anything to say on an important topic like this, it seems like it's being left to the context of the reader. Like the reader should know something already that, you know, it's left unsaid, right? Mm-hmm. And so I was trying, so that's, you know, kind of how we do the triangulation in HEMA, you know, that term, the triangulation. On the one hand, we study the sources, you know, the idea being if our objective is to recreate a lost historical martial art, then we can't actually talk to those people, then we need to test our methods somehow. And if we do different things, we can extrapolate, you know, to improve our understanding. So on the one hand, triangulation, you know, on the one hand, you look at the sources and try to, you know, interpret the sources as closely and accurately as possible. But then on the other side, you know, one other edge of the point of the triangle would be sparring, right? Full speed adversarial sparring in order to, again, to try to test those techniques in a, you know, the crucible of adversarial full speed, you know, mm-hmm. environment to see if it that the technique is valid, or if your interpretation of the technique is valid. Then the third point of the triangle is, I think, conventionally in HEMA wisdom is cutting, right? Cutting to tummy mats or other medium like clay in order to test whether our actions are, would have an effect, right? In a fight, quote, in a real fight, quote. So this whole wounding investigation for me is just kind of that cutting. It's that point of the triangle. It's another way of understanding, hey, what would be efficacious or effective, and how would that change my understanding of what the fencing treatises that we study are trying to tell us to do. So does that make any sense? Does anybody have any questions about that before I move on? Because then I'm going to move on to some tech.
All right, raise your hand if you have a question. I'll call you out, and Brent, or you can unmute yourself, I guess. But I'll call you out, and then you can unmute yourself. Josh has a question.
Hey, Josh.
Here it is. He's typed it out. The idea of your working with is the reader, an experienced fighter, knows, and there might have been cultural obligations. And then Henry says, observation, those streaks descending from the text look like MAGA speed lines emphasizing this. Oh, manga, I think. Yeah, speed lines emphasizing the descending. Those are calligraphic flourishes. So for the F's and the S's in texts like this, look at that initial capital letter on the left, how crazy that thing is. I just want to point out that those descending lines are probably calligraphic flourishes. Having attempted to forge one of these things, that's one thing I definitely pick up on.
Calligraphic flourishes, otherwise known as manga speed lines.
Right? Yes, exactly.
Real quick, Josh, did you still have a question or comment? Because your hand is still raised.
I'm sorry, I'm getting used to this UI.
No worries.
I'm good.
Hey, Josh.
Just wanted to make sure.
Good to hear your voice again.
Hey, Josh. Yeah, man. Good to see you.
Hey, y'all. I guess that was my question. Is that sort of the idea that you're going down, Will?
Yeah, right. So that's part of this. And I'm kind of hiding the ball a little bit, Josh, but you're on to it. I'll talk about this a little bit right now since the question was posed. When I started this, I had the misconception that the Kunstis Fechtens, KDF was about, immediately ending the fight through wounding, right? Like stopping power sort of thing, right? In the way that we understand it today, if you are exposed to any kind of self-defense, theory or whatever, you want to end the fight through incapacitation, right? but that's an interesting, it's interesting in that our understanding of violence in that way is very narrow in that historically speaking, after researching this for a few years now, I really do think that even though people indeed, drew swords and other deadly weapons and engaged in combat with those deadly weapons, that did not necessarily mean that anybody was trying to kill the other. And often it didn't end in death or even injury because of those social norms, right? And that's a little bit outside the scope of this lecture. I think that also that Charles could probably speak with more authority on that given the research that he's done. So I'm not gonna go too far down that rabbit hole because it's a really cool tangent to go down. Does that answer the question a little bit, Josh?
It does. I was just trying to figure out. I was trying to rephrase your sort of thesis there. But no, I got
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
thank you.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right, I don't know.
Anything else? Moving on.
I don't know if you can see the chat, Will, but Simon has a question.
Yeah, I can't see anything except.
Oh, he says. Okay, he asks, do any of the other wound depictions show blood? The other two pictures didn't seem to.
No, right? This one has a little bit of blood, right? The thrust through the abdomen or the chest.
Yeah, it's very different from out. It's very different from there's that one Talhoffer illustration with a guy's hands getting cut off,
and it's just a
shower of blood coming out.
Ah, hold on.
Oh yeah, there you go. Yeah, there look at that.
Hold on, let me do this a little bit better.
For that nice illustration at the beginning of Mike's cutting book where the head's being decapitated.
I was thinking about having that one instead of this one, but I didn't want to make anybody too squeamish. But yeah, so you know, so sources vary, right? They vary in their depictions of wounds. However, what's interesting is that most of them don't really depict wounds, and they don't even talk about it. So for example, here, I'm focusing on the last part. This is the Zornhau play. You know, yada yada, Zornhau, then the Ort happens, right? Zornhau Ort. If he is then skipping down to the last sentence, if he is then soft on the sword, then shoot in the long point straight before you and stab him to the face or to the breast. Right? It says stab him to the face or to the breast. And I know that we're dealing with with a translation here. But that, you know, that's where the play ends, right? Stab to the face or the breast. It's almost non-committal. Like, it's not saying, if I were writing this and I had in my mind, well, I need to tell somebody how to inflict the best wound they can given the fencing circumstance, I would probably, maybe I would phrase it differently and say, stab to the face or breast and drive well, in order to, inflict a wound. But it's almost like the glossators don't, like the wound is, it's an afterthought. It's not even worth mentioning, right? So for example, again, this one here, this is the Mutirin. Looking at the top paragraph, again, last kind of clause here, wind on your left side with a short edge on his sword. So you get that point online and drive up well with your arms. And here's the last part, and drive in with your sword's blade above over his sword and stab into the lower opening, right? So we're being told to stab into a fencing construct, the lower opening, okay? They don't even care about telling you which part of, the body. It's not about, again, kind of, it's frustrating, right? For us, if we're thinking about, hey, how do I kill him? How do I inflict a wound? Like, that's what swords are for, right? So I need to know how to do that, right? Well, the sources don't, that's what swords are for. The sources don't, they don't have the same approach that we might have, and that I certainly had previously. The last one I'm going to show is the Krumpal against an Oberhau. You give the opening, yada yada, into Schrankhood on the right. Also, guys, everybody, I know that not everybody is familiar with the Kunstisfechtens. That's not super important, really. I'm just focusing on the approach to the infliction of wounds in the sources. So don't worry if you don't follow the play. So again, last sentence, if you then hews into the opening, then spring from the hue with your right foot, etc., and strike him with the long edge with crossed hands with the point on his hands. Okay, so this one is a little bit more satisfying, right? We're told to strike him, right? That's kind of satisfying because previously, like we're thrusting into openings and stuff, but at least we're told to strike him. And then moreover, we're told to strike with the point, with the long edge, with the point on his hands. And that's a specific target, isn't it? It's a little bit more satisfying. But it's varied, right? It's varied. So I'm going to show you my spreadsheet later, but I have another spreadsheet where I went through and kind of categorized every play in the Kunstisfechtens across Danzig, Ringeck, and the house book, MS-3227A, into like, do they even like, what's the target, are we given a target? And half the time it's agnostic or ambiguous. Like half the time it's into the opening. The other half is kind of, sometimes it's not even there, but the minority of the time are we actually told, strike the head or thrust into the, whatever. So the takeaway here is I'm just trying, basically what I'm doing is I'm showing you why I got frustrated with the source's approach to wounding. Does anybody have any questions about this before I move on to the next sort of phase of this presentation? Does anybody share my frustration? Like, why do we even fence?
Well, right? One question I have is, what is their knowledge of anatomy at the time? And what is their own conception, not maybe not the reality, but their own conception of wounding and being wounded. So now we have the knowledge of anatomy, and so we say, okay, if I'm shot, you know, center of mass and in the heart, I'm going to die very, very quickly. In the Civil War, they knew if they were shot low, they were likely to die very long, agonizing death. Now the question here is, what's the impact? What's the effect of these wounds? What's their conception? And then does that play into their fencing theory at all? Or is there something else that's driving the consequences of their actions?
Yeah, I know, right? That's a good question. I think though, the way that I would like to respond to that, Charles, it's going to be kind of to undercut your assumption that the Kuntz suspectants of the treatises that we study are interested in inflicting a wound that will have a certain effect. Okay. I'm not. So what I mean by that is, like, I'm not. So first of all, stopping power. Let's talk about stopping power. Everybody knows what stopping power is, right? Stopping power is when you wound the guy, you know, whether it's shooting center mass or whatever, they stop, and you're not in danger anymore. Because this is a life threatening scenario, and if you don't kill him, he's going to kill you, and you better kill immediately, right? That's we understand that today because we live in a world of hyper deadly firearms, that are incredibly easy, to conceal, and when you start shooting, then people start, dying, right? So therefore, maybe the theory for us is, kill early, kill quickly. That's the way that you win a fight, right? That's how you win a fight nowadays. Make sense?
Yeah.
Is that right?
I mean, yeah.
So if we bring that understanding of violence and of combat back, like, with us when we look at these historical sources, I think that we're doing ourselves a disservice, because I don't think that's how they understood sword fighting or combat, okay? Which seems crazy, right? Again, talking, like, when I responded to Josh's question, what else might be going on here, socially or otherwise? I've read a bunch of accounts now of fighting with swords and otherwise, and it does not necessarily end in death or injury. There's a continuum of violence that goes all the way up to death, sure, but you can de-escalate and you can escalate in that continuum in a way that nowadays. It's more like a fist fight now, right? If you get in a fist fight, which I've never really been in a fist fight either, right? So we're ignorant. We really are. Most of us here are ignorant of actual violence. But in a fist fight, there's not this, it's not like you have to kill the person or even seriously injure the person, right? You can stop, right? Yeah. And I think swords are more deadly than fists. But it's more like I think that the historical understanding of the fight and wounding in the fight was more like a fist fight and less like a shooting match, like a gunfight in terms of wounding and lethality. And that's why I think, Charles, that feel free to respond. That's why I think that the assumption of, like, anatomy and stuff like that, that's thinking about, well, what did they know about stopping power,
Right, right, yeah. No, completely agree.
Yeah, okay. Anybody have any questions about anything like that?
We've got a bunch of questions here. I'll just take a few of them. Let's see. Most of them are just comments.
Comment section is going wild.
Yes.
Yeah, it looks like most of them are comments.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Okay. Well, if there are any questions, I can keep going.
Oh, yeah. So Ryan is raising his hand.
Yeah.
Hey, Ryan.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, yeah, no, so I was wondering, is it more, because, I'm reading this book that I acquired during the Yule Duel about, living in in Germany during that time period, and about combat, and it was, they were ready for war at all times, it seems. But there was also, most of their fighting, it seemed, was internal city conflict. So is it maybe that balance of both? I don't know. That's my question, is obviously there was two kinds of fighting.
Yeah, so like, is it the martial ethic in early modern Germany by Hans Lutzi?
Yeah.
Good
that's
book.
That's like a Bible, everybody. If you can get your hands on that book, just do it. Bite the bullet and do it, because that, better than anything else, better than the research I did, really informs how these, like the context of the sources that we study, really does. Yeah, I think you're on. I think that's exactly correct, Ryan. There's a whole lot of different types of violence and the responsibilities of bearing arms and being, you know, being in control of your, you know, of your actions, such that, you know, you can be trusted by the polity, by the civic, you know, by society to carry your arms, as is your duty. And by the way, you know, we're talking about German cities, as opposed to other, you know, yeoman farmers or otherwise in the countryside, as opposed to nobles, you know, feudal rulers, and as opposed to the clergy. All of those different society or classes have different contexts, and that's interesting. That there's so many good sources. One is the coroner's rolls for reading about historical violence. The coroner's rolls are in English. They've been translated, a lot of them. They're medieval source. They're medieval texts given from medieval England, where if somebody was killed, then the coroner, which is, you know, a person appointed, I think, by the king or some, you know, anyway, the coroner is an official that would go out and check out the body and see, you know, does there need to be a report made. So like drowning, you know, lots of drowning sadly happened, lots of children being like drowning and trying to wash themselves, people slipping and falling, and it gets, you know, infected and they die. You know, stuff like that. But included in that, you know, a subset of the instances reported in the coroner's rolls are obviously armed, you know, encounters where somebody gets wounded and dies either there or later. And so the coroner would write a report and give. I think he would either write a report or go in front of the king's judge, riding circuit around the realm, and give his report to the king's judge. That's where we get the term circuit courts, by the way. But the king's judge would have a scribe that, yeah, no, isn't that cool? The king's judge would have a scribe to write down that report, and the and then they would take that report and they would hold on to it back with them in the central administrative center. And that's why we have these coroner's rolls. The roll is like just a long piece of whatever, parchment or whatever. But anyway, the coroner's rolls of Oxford. Oxford is a really cool example because Ryan, it has a mix of these different classes. So Ryan, you're reading probably, I think I've read a lot of Tlutzi, but not everything in the book. But in Oxford, it's both a city, and it's a ecclesiastical center. So, you know, religious orders, and they have different rules. So the Oxford was wild. The students, the clerics, and, you know, that are studying to be professional religious, you know, administrators in the medieval time. They were a rowdy bunch. They were armed at all times, it seems. They were assaulting and often killing lay people, townsfolk, and people around Oxford. They were doing it with swords and bucklers, messers, which were called, I think a lot of them were called falchions or just swords, and even some billhooks and things like that, daggers, obviously. And so whenever this happened, the coroner would give his report and it would be reported. And so... So the context of the different encounters is incredibly important to keep in mind, and that really, I think, that informs also how we approach the sources. So a good inquiry would be to think about what each source, who the audience of each source might be. So for example, there's a difference between the audience of most festivals, so like Talhofer, for example, and a lot of like who was a polished cow. They had very wealthy patrons. That's why they had these incredible books written, because it's expensive. But their wealthy patrons, you know, were subsidizing or buying the manufacturer of these books. And those patrons were very high noble, you know, class. So these books are written for nobles, right? Essentially for nobles. MS-3227A, the house book, is different. It's I don't know, Charles or anybody. I don't know exactly who wrote that. I don't know if we have an author, but it's probably like a burgher, right? Like a townsperson.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know, but it's just basically someone's house book, which they scribbled spells. What else? Mining, stuff on minerals, toothpaste recipes, fireworks, and fencing. Yeah. Like an entire fencing treatise.
And it was in their house, right? It was like kept with them. So it wasn't written by somebody for somebody. It was kind of maintained by them for them and their descendants and their family. So that's just two examples of the context that differs even within the Cusus Vectens glosses that we have. And I think it might be a little bit neglected in how we approach the sources, because we tend to do it, you know, we like to do the martial arts, analyze the movements and everything, but I think the context of the sources is important to understand why they may have neglected to talk about the wounds and stuff.
If I could just plug my own work temporarily. Well, I noticed the same thing when looking at Wallerstein or von Baumann's book, also the Nuremberg treatises. But basically, structurally, they're very different from KDF sources. They're one-off plays, and a large fraction of them do not end in any kind of lethal kill, like a lethal strike, no stabs, no hews, no slices, not even to the extent of KDF. And so the question came about, like, why is this book so different from the others? Which kind of led me down this very similar path. But the question is, you know, who was this book for, and what context shapes how techniques are chosen, how they're depicted?
Which book is that, Charles?
Wallerstein was the primary source that I used, or that I examined, that led me down a lot of consideration about what the context for this violence was.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
that's interesting. Very interesting. And these are, you know, we just have a lot of questions, right? I don't have any answers to.
yeah. I mean, it's not even clear, right? Like, we look at Tlusti a lot, but it's not even clear that early KDF is done by burghers.
I agree. Yeah, I know. I don't think it is. No, I don't think it is.
Yeah, it could be fighting men, but I mean, certainly what's valuable is that it gives us an alien context for violence. Something that's completely unknown to us. I don't want to say completely unknown, but just it's very alien to a modern reader, the types of violence that exist, at least within one city, the social norms in the context of the use of violence. Okay, yeah, I've been talking too much.
Yeah, great question, Ryan. Again, read everybody on this who's listening to my voice, buy or acquire The Martial Ethic in Early Modern Germany, and just give it a nice close read, or even skim through it. Give you a really good idea of the context of the sources that we study so far.
Yeah, I mean, it might be good to do have someone do a book report. Oh, never mind. Let's go to this. This part's awesome.
Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah. So just moving on a little bit. Because that was a long answer. There's some cool stuff. Specifically when I started on this path of research, I had a question about some specific passages in Pseudo Peter von Danzig and Sigmund Heinrich Eck's glosses. So for those of you who are not familiar with that, Pseudo Peter von Danzig and Sigmund Heinrich are two different authors of glosses of Lichtenauer's Zettel recital of the Kunstes Fechtens, Art of Combat. And that's the source. Those are, quote, the sources that we're talking about, that we study. They have there are three. there are three references in each of these, so a total of six references to cutting through the mouth or the maw. Like Dan, in Danzig, it's mouth, and Ringa, it's maw, and that's just the translator, different translators, different translations. But I think it's kind of the same thing. I'm not sure though. But I came to these, and I thought, like, why the mouth? You know, because again, it's one of those things. Like, it's so the source, the glosses are all over the place. Sometimes they tell you to thrust into that, to the opening, to the upper or lower opening, which isn't even a body part. And then other times they tell you the mouth, you know. And so what's going on there? So let me just show you a few of the sources. I only have a three here, I think, because there's six. But the one comes in the doubling after the Zornhau ring. It shows up earliest in Ring Up of the Zornhau. So you cut down if he parries with strength, so he's pushing you aside. Then you do clear. You double in the moment. Pommel under the right arm. And then here it is, and strike him through the maw with crossed hands upon the sword behind his sword's blade, yada yada. We're striking with a plan upon that. This is the duplirin. This is kind of, you know, from a bind, striking behind the bind. And it's, there you go, you see it, strike him through the maw, through the mouth. So that's kind of, that's evocative, right? the other one, this is, let's see, I think this is Pseudo-Peter von Danzig. This is from the Tverhau. Ring also has some Tverhau stuff that mentions the maw or the mouth. If you strike him with the Tverhau on his right side, if he then follows with the slice on the arm, so he's slicing down on your arms, then you can counter that by striking him in his mouth with the Duplirin, the doubling, behind his sword's blade with the short edge. So again, the Duplirin, like Duplirin mean, like, is directed at the mouth for some reason. In a lot of these, Danzig and Ringek. And then the continuation of that, again, it's more, you know, cutting through the mouth. Or if you strike him with the Tver on his left side, so this is just the other side. So yeah, so these two are kind of the same thing. So I was thinking, why the mouth? What's going on here, cutting through the mouth? And so as I started doing some research, that's what kind of started me on my catalog of wounds. So what I did, ultimately, I made a wound catalog, is what I call it. And basically, what I started with this book. This is another book that you absolutely must purchase if you're interested in combat with swords, because it is nothing but a compilation, 740 pages of accounts of combat with swords. Now, it starts from 1600s, which is outside most of our interest. But here's the thing, it deals with unarmored, like very lightly armored or unarmored combatants, which is, you know, that's what we're interested in, right? Blossfechten. So I thought it was a good place to start analyzing this. And so what I did is I went through and I made a DA Kingsley. So this is a link here if we can distribute this presentation later. But anyway, I went through and I made a spreadsheet. So what I did I thought it made sense to for every you know, cut, thrust, or strike, or anything, any action that wounds, that makes contact with an opponent, to try to catalog each action with the weapon that makes contact with the opponent and determine its effects, right? Its target, its effects, in order to figure out what's going on, you know, what's going on with the maybe through quantity we can suss out some ideas or some results for, targeting one part of the body is effective at stopping fight. I was still thinking about, you know, stopping power, right? I didn't have nearly the nuance that we've articulated in this presentation. But this is just a snapshot of it. I don't want to talk through all this. I just want to tell you the method that I used to build this spreadsheet. It got up into this, just for British sword fighters, it was about 1500 lines, which is great. A lot of data, right? And this link takes, and so the link here takes you to it. It's a link on the blog post that I made. So if you're a data person, please check it out. And also, if you are a data person, you know how to do cool things with spreadsheets, let me know if you're interested in collaborating to really bring this to life. Because the cool thing about this is that accounts fall out of it. So sure enough, there's some accounts of cutting through the mouth, you know, mouth cuts. So here's where it gets graphic, everybody. Remember, there's a content warning on this lecture. This is the graphic part because it describes in gory detail the effects of blades on bare flesh. And the cuts through the mouth are maybe the most gruesome of all. But anyway, after I did this research, there were I think four. There were four accounts of people being cut through the mouth. So here's the first one. This is from Thomas Brownlee. I think this was in 1697. And God, is that that's not the English Civil War, is it? It may be the Scottish War. Anyway, the Scots were fighting, and the account goes, this is a snippet of it. Though I was faint for loss of blood, I left him, he was fighting somebody, Mr. Brownlee. I left him no time for another blow. My sword glanced on his shoulder, cut through his buff coat, which is a type of thick coat that is on some armor, and flesh, swept through his jaw and laid open his throat from ear to ear. The fire, et cetera, of his eyes quenched in a moment. He reeled, falling with a terrible clash. He poured out his soul with a torrent of blood on the heath. So what happened here, right? This is an example of me cataloging. I just copy-pasted this from the spreadsheet. The account here is the sword impacted through the armor that he's wearing, the buff coat, and then swept upward through his jaw all the way and cut open his neck. But it sounds like the account was saying that the sword went through the jaw itself, right? Cutting the jaw. Cutting the neck through the jaw. It's a little bit ambiguous here, but that's one account. So the next account is from 1832 during the Portuguese Civil War. British Mr. Alexander Palmer, British person, was taking part. And this is an interesting one. This is just a snippet, but a Portuguese officer had ridden forward to parley or, you know, to talk. And so Mr. Palmer, I think with a couple other people, went out and to talk to this Portuguese officer. But the Portuguese officer drew his sword and started, you know, and was about to cut. So Lieutenant Wilkinson, so Alexander Chalmers is the chronicler. Lieutenant Wilkinson is doing the cutting. So Lieutenant Wilkinson made a cut five across, which is a type of, I think, right to left horizontal cut, across the fellow's face with such force that his lower jaw fell on his chest. He was only a few yards from me, and although the occurrence was instantaneous, I distinctly saw the inside of his gullet. Doubtless the blow would have been repeated, but the fellow dashed away and disappeared.
That's awesome.
Okay. Yeah. So it's, you know, this is gory stuff. I apologize if it makes you squeamish. But here's the thing. We're talking about stopping power. Physiologically killing the person. Well, here the effect of the wound was to stop the fight, wasn't it? Because the guy turned and ran, ostensibly because of the horror of the whole situation, of suddenly having his jaw laying on the top of his chest. Next one is from a French Lieutenant General Baron de Marbeau. This account is a snippet. The whole account, it starts off with Baron Marbeau is. He's doing a messenger run, or he's doing something that he shouldn't be doing. He's alone and isolated. And then two hussars come out and pursue him on horseback. So this is a horseback encounter, which also most of these are horseback encounters. So Mr. Marbeau gets in a fight. There are two opponents. Mr. Marbeau says, I replied with a vigorous backhander. My blade struck his teeth and passed between his jaws as if he was in the act of shouting, slitting his mouth to the ears. He made off promptly to my lively satisfaction, for he was by far the braver and more energetic of the two. Okay, so like similar to the previous one, right? It didn't kill anybody, right? But it was effective in stopping that fight, at least the, you know, that encounter with that one combatant. Those are three examples that I found of cutting through the jaw and its effects on stopping the fight. And so going back to the Kunstdisfechten stuff, perhaps targeting the mouth was something that was understood to be possible, or maybe we're told to target the mouth for for the reason that it's an effective way to, you know, to inflict a grievous fight-stopping wound. But the counter, that may be true, but the counterpoint partially is that one of those, remember, if you remember the Tverhau cut, the counter to the Tverhau, I'm thinking about something else. So I'm sorry, I didn't put this one up here, but one of the instances where the mouth is talked about is when his sword is in your mouth, that he's cutting you through the mouth, and what you do to get his sword off, it's in the Tverhau play. This really extended Tverhau play. So perhaps there was kind of this like horror of getting cut through the mouth, you know, where your jaw lays on the top of your chest, but was something that that the sources, you know, the gloss fitters were worried about. I remember reading in what's the guy's name? Charles or somebody may have to help me here, but he writes about violence, talking about martial artists.
Rory Miller.
Rory Miller. Yeah, exactly. The name of his book just gave me. But one of the things that struck me is he wrote a book. It's really informative. His opinion is that martial arts tend to practice the thing that scares the masters the most, or scares the practitioners the most. So like, if you think about the Japanese I'm not good with the terminology, but the Japanese sword art where you're both kneeling at like a conference, and then suddenly the other guy draws a sword and you got to be ready, right? Quick draw, Iaido, right? Yeah. So that's, and that, you know, you practice that like crazy, right? It's like, you know, so perhaps something like that is going on here, where Rory Miller identified, in his opinion, he identified that martial arts tend to practice and tend to focus on the thing that scares them the most, that they have to be most prepared for. And so maybe the cut through the mouth is something like that. But anyway, those are all the slides that I have that I prepared for this. There's a whole lot I can talk about.
I've got another mouth cut incident for you, or example. I for sure you'll throw it away though. It's from the Icelandic sagas, and there's an instance where a man, and this has actually happened two times. I'm not sure if it's the same individual, but it's told from two different perspectives. A man gets his mouth cut open, and his jaw is hanging on his chest. And in one account, he then says, "My face never was handsome, and you have done little to improve it." But in both accounts, he takes his beard, he puts it in his mouth, and he holds fast the rest of his jaw while he continues to fight. Number one, Icelandic saga. So, you know, it doesn't have kind of the same like clinical objectiveness, I mean, or at least relatively speaking, compared to kind of D.A. Kingsley's accounts. But then also, they might be using that account to show what a badass he is. You know, like he got cut through the mouth, which normally most people would just go running from. And he just shoved his beard in his mouth and just kept fighting.
Oh, one second. Josh, do you have a question? I see you have your hand raised.
Can't hear you, Josh, if you're talking.
Now.
Yep, can hear you. Good.
Josh, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yep. We can hear you.
Okay. A couple thoughts. One is, depending on who, you were talking about who the audience is, it could be that some of these plays were just to, okay, in this situation, this is how you execute this to fill time and CYA. It could be that in some other situations, depending on who the audience is, you end up actually close enough to be able to execute something like what happens with these Virchow plays that you've been mentioning. Whereas some of the other text, it seemed like it was go to an opening because you're trying to collapse distance between you and your opponent, but not necessarily end the fight. It's just a, okay, if you have this correct geometry, do X, Y, Z to bridge the gap. Is there any way, I know it'd be hell with the spreadsheet, but is there any way to figure out what range, I mean, you have the different type of weapons which sort of imply range, but the range at which the fight started, when they started to describe the action versus just a generic mechanical, you do this, followed by this, followed by this.
In the spreadsheet or in the sources that we study?
Both, because there's some sources where, again, back to your idea of who the audience was that they were written for and the context of everything. Some of these sources were judicial duels. Not very few of them were, here's what you do out on the open battlefield. And then in the Icelandic tale, they're just going out of their way to tell everybody what badasses they are. And they have absolute pain, compliance, non-compliance, whatever the term is, to just be able to trek on no matter how many times somebody hits them. is there any way to correlate the distance in which the text is talking about the action from the starting? Because by the end of the play, if you're able to cut his jaw open, you're close enough. But at the end of the play, it just may end up, you come to an impasse. You had all this stuff, and up to that final finishing point, in which case it's up to the user to have their discretion of how to end the fight from there. The opening should be apparent, I guess.
So the mouth cut stuff definitely, is too clear and stuff. So it has to happen quite close, right? I think maybe the what's going on with the Kunstaspekten sources, at least, is that they're adhering closely to, the adage of striking to the nearest opening, and that the glosses are, examples of the best way to, the best opening to take and the best way to take the opening, the best wounder to use. So that might be part of it. Again, it's kind of like the technical fencing answer. In terms of cataloging it, that's something I didn't track measure, because they don't really even, because spectrums around here, it's Zoofecton or Creed, it's one or the other. So they don't give you this Renaissance thought, measure gradation. But you have to kind of suss it out, and then you're running to the issue of, is your interpretation correct or not? But with the spreadsheet I made, the measure stuff, you can, I didn't track measure at all, but you can get an idea of it because what sort of swords they were using, what sort of weapons they're using, because we understand what the British customers were using, during the period when the account originated. Does that make sense? So if you wanted to, you can go back and sort of get an idea. Like the Portuguese one where the Portuguese soldier got cut through the mouth was definitely sabers, and it was on horseback as well. So,
gotcha. Thanks.
Also, I think it's Ian. Are you familiar with wounds and wound repair in medieval culture?
Yeah, Larissa Tracy's book. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's awesome. I did. I read there are some good accounts of wounds in there. I used there are a few that that I was able to catalog, but outside of the actual mechanical blow by blow thing, I think that's an incredibly valuable book to read to understand how medieval people thought about wounds, especially depicting wounds, because she it's a in that book there's a collection of authors, so the authors write essay, some of the essays are about the depiction of wounds in medieval art and what that means to the the meaning of the depiction of the wound to the viewer, the contemporaneous viewer of the art. And which is very incredibly valuable to us because we don't have that medieval mindset, and so we have to go back and figure it out for ourselves. I need to give that thing another read, given after now that I have a better understanding of the agnostic nature of wounding and the gruesome spectens. I think that might be very valuable to understand, especially a lot of the sources, to understand the depiction of wounding and what it may mean. So for example, here, Talhofer, this is his one of his fencing treatises, his later ones. He has other ones too. And actually, we think about Talhofer as like, the gory one. If you go through, it's not actually, most of his work is not, it follows the same tradition as the other earlier sources that we're familiar with. And that it just shows, the placement of the point, or, the edge is just kind of touching the guy's head. None of this gory stuff. So I don't know. I have a pet theory about why wounding became more widely depicted as time went on, because that does seem to be a trend. Medieval manuscripts and glosses typically didn't depict the wound, but later Renaissance glosses did depict the wound a lot more. I'm not sure why. But that's something we can discuss. You have any other questions, comments?
I swear there's a Talhofer picture that has way more blood than this.
Oh yeah, I didn't pick the bloodiest one.
Yeah, okay.
Because we just got done talking about really gory stuff, so. Yeah. And there's also a great... Oh yeah, sorry.
Oh, question from Marlene.
Yeah.
She and raised hand from Henry. All right, Marlene's question is, has this impacted your fencing at all?
Yeah, it has. Initially, it impacted my fencing by making me think, how do I want to, what target do I want to take, or what opening do I want to take to end the fight, quote. But more recently, it's influenced my fencing by allowing me to see all the possible targets and all the possible openings and ways to take the openings, and I'm able to choose the various grades of lethality, because in my mind, at least, the distinction between the buffel and the master is that the master can choose in the fight and the buffel cannot choose. So if I want to try to be a master in the Kunstspektens understanding of it, then I want to be able to choose. And by choosing, by not immediately, shooting that point straight through the jaw or the neck, but instead maybe laying the, going for the schnitt on the arms, the controller, and going for the schnitt across the neck or something. Those are less immediately lethal than a thrust through the neck, obviously. And so this research it made me realize that there are a lot more options and a lot more variations and gradations of violence even within a sword fight in a way that I didn't understand previously. We do a lot of this in master classes that on Tuesdays. We have asymmetric sparring, where one person can't kill, etc. The other person we do different scenarios, but the other person may be okay with throwing that thrust in there, and that really brings to life via all the different manuscript with the options that the manuscripts give you.
Henry has a question.
Henry.
So this is actually more of an observation than a question, but it dawned on me, and this is because when I was at Western Martial Arts Workshop, I'd taken one of Jess Finley's courses, and she's been looking at hunting texts. And it dawned on me, especially for most of the class of people who these books are written, that were a lot of these books were written for, but even if you look at the more townsman-y type books, you're dealing with people who hunted and or some of them killed their own animals. So what I'm thinking is that these are people who are already acquainted with killing or stabbing things in a sense that culturally, so when it talks about the, you know, driving the point home or just putting the point in, you've already got somebody who's kind of used to, you know, if they've hunted deer or something, they kind of know what's going to happen when you shove the point in. I'm just putting that out there as that whole sort of unwritten cultural thing that we're trying to get our hands on. But that's one of the things that came to my mind when we were talking about this, and maybe not the depiction of wounds, because if you've hunted, you know, a deer with a spear or something, you kind of, or a hunting sword even, you kind of know what happens. I'm just, that's my observation.
I'm just going to do a really quick shameless plug. So on April 9th, Jess Finley will come and talk to us specifically about hunting. That's all. Take it away, Will.
Dang. Nice. Okay. Thanks so much for bringing it up, Henry. No, really. That's something I should have incorporated into the lecture here or the slides, but no, that's awesome. Thanks for bringing it up. I think that, so that's another, I think that's another lost context that we don't understand in the same way as the contemporaries would have understood, you know, these glosses. I think that the killing of animals was a lot realer to those people than it is to us. You know, obviously we don't, I mean, I don't know if I've ever killed anything other than like a bug or something, right? Because I didn't grow up hunting or anything.
Does anybody grow up on a farm?
Yeah, so like if you grew up on a farm, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So yeah, it was a more agrarian society, et cetera. So yeah, so I think that perhaps, you know, it'd be like, you know, discussing, you know, it would be superfluous, right? Because it's just, again, it's a lost context. Like that part of that understanding and part of the culture was something that was very clear for everybody, or at least for the readers. So perhaps I didn't want to, you know, spend much time on that. Example that I have been able to find of specific instructions on how to better wound, like how do you wound the best, right? That's what I'm, that's what we're interested in, right? As modern people trying to reconstruct this stuff, like how do I best wound? You know, that's why we cut to Tommy, et cetera. The best thing that I found is from João the First, I think, is the Portuguese hunting manual or book. The Portuguese king, and I can't remember the name of it. I can go grab it, but I don't want to walk away from the computer. But he tells you, he gives you specific instructions about how to best drive your thrust into the quarry, into the game. And it's nothing, you know, it's nothing earth shattering. It's basically all the good structure stuff that we know. But it's also from horseback, so that's a little bit different. But you know, but it's so like the evidence that I have been able to find is just structure, right? Have good structure. So maybe that's a takeaway. You know, this depiction of cutting a hand off, that has to, you have to have some good structure to do that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, don't the treatises in their preamble generally say, you know, this is for people who otherwise know how to fence. So there's a background assumption about what people are arriving to this treatise with, whether it's hunting knowledge or knowing the effect of their weapons on people. And, you know, it's kind of like, oh yeah, you know what to do from here, right? Like once you get the opening, you know, just you do it. you figure it out.
I know.
It's
not satisfying, right? Because we don't
know. Yeah. Please tell us.
And also all the plays just right the end, right? It's like, and thrust in the lower opening. Right? So it's, and here's the thing. I really do think after kind of analyzing a little bit of this stuff from this perspective, that the Kusis faction glosses and sources, they don't talk about wounding and stuff because they're not about that. They're about the technical aspects of how to fence better. They're not about, you know, how to end the fight. They're not even really about like an actual fight. They're about how to better fence, which is different than, you know, fighting best and, you know, never, you know, preserving your life, you know, or whatever. It's not a self-defense treatise. It's a fencing treatise, right? Those are different.
Yeah. Steve Cheney says in his comment, it's a toolbox.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. That's carried me the furthest when I to think about the KDF as a series of tools to use in the right scenarios. Mm-hmm. It's not about wounding. That's the takeaway.
yeah.
It's not about.
Yeah, I mean, it's worth it to think about kind of what elements of the modern context generate this fascination with wounding, mm-hmm. in a way that might not have translated to the 15th or 16th century. So generally, like self-defense laws, and also kind of the concentration of like state-sponsored violence. You know, it's made it so that I personally am not generally expected to keep the peace. I don't need to detain anyone. I don't need to get into conflicts if someone is, if they break into my house, I don't have to hold them down. I call the police, or at least that's the expectation. And the only scenarios in which I'm really thinking about using violence is to protect my own life or the people around me. And it's kind of a very binary decision, like, and that's that binary use of force is kind of supported by all of the other structures of violence and law enforcement that are part of our modern society. Whereas in the 15th and 16th century, or at least depending on your context, I don't want to place it, make it one giant bucket, but depending on where you are, there are different legal structures that change the expectations of violence that each person has.
Yeah. Where did the Kunstsuspektens glosses fit into that context, right?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah.
I mean, that's an open question. Know. Yeah. Yeah.
It is. My personal theory, and I'm the presenter, but that doesn't mean that I'm right, is that if a lot of these glosses were for noble people, then it was about artful fencing, right? It wasn't about it wasn't specifically about, so here's how you, you know, fight, you know, on the streets or battlefield or whatever. It was about artful fencing, and that was what one of the aspects of your, you know, life and reason for existence. If you are a noble in the 15th century, you know, you have to, it's like a, you know, you have to know how to fence in the correct, you know, artful way. And I think personally, I think the Kunstsuspektens is more about that than it is specifically about, you know, the violence of the wound and that aspect.
So it was for sport.
It was for, you know, it was for everything, but it was mainly theory that the sources, I mean, the glosses.
Also, a shameless plug, in 2 weeks, we're having Adam Franti, who's going to lecture on factual culture. So we're really going to stretch the notion of sport fencing there.
Yeah, Franti's awesome on that.
And shameless plug.
Okay. Cool, any other questions?
Doesn't look like we have any other questions at the moment.
Cool. Well, thanks everybody. That's the presentation that I have. There's a lot more. Again, I have the spreadsheets available online on my blog post that I made about this ages ago now. And I haven't gone anywhere really with it since then. But I'm interested in maybe making the data more accessible, because these accounts of wounds in combat are very useful, but they're useful like not quantitatively, you know, in a spreadsheet, but rather, you know, qualitatively. Like I want people to be able to access these things. So if anybody has spreadsheet boo or you know Excel powers, and you want to participate in this project, it'd be awesome to get in touch.
Yeah, well, thanks for talking to us. Let me just give a quick rundown of other speakers we have, just to get you all hyped up. Next week, we're going to have Kaya Sadowski. She's an instructor in Vancouver who runs Valkyrie Martial Arts. And she helps also, I believe she trains the Vancouver Police Department there. And she's going to talk about being a better training partner. She's a really great speaker on that. The week after that, on April 2nd, Adam Franti will be talking about effectual culture, basically public fencing in the 16th century, and you know, giving you an idea of what is a sport and what can a sport be. There's a lot of common dichotomy between sport and like kind of real combat fencing. I'm doing air quotes, you can't see it. So there's his lecture is going to try to give you additional context and color on what sport, again air quotes, fencing might look like. After that, we have Jess Finley. She'll be talking about hunting and the hunting context for a lot of KDF sources. And then after that, we have Kendra Brown. She'll be discussing depictions of women in armor. So you know, today we have modern depictions of women in armor. Kendra's question is, how did people at the time depict women in armor? There are many depictions, and she goes through a lot of them, and it's really cool, really fascinating to think about depictions of armor, and then gender, and then gender through armor. Basically, feel free to hang out, chat, everyone, you can unmute yourself, just make this a chaotic shit show now. But yeah, thank you, Will, and I hope to see you all next week.
Thanks for setting this up.
Thank you, Will, for taking the time to do this.
Thanks, Will.
Welcome.
Yeah, thanks, everybody.